If you've heard anything lately about tests, it's that we haven't performed enough of them in the United States.
Today, everyone is so focused on getting tested, they miss the point that a bad test is worse than no test.
And that may be another more fundamental problem. Just how good are the tests in the first place?
The FDA basically has created a wild, wild west environment for this testing, where under their approval process on an emergency basis, they've let tests on the market that basically have a very, very wide range of results.
Michael Osterholm is director of the Center for Infectious Disease Research and Policy at the University of Minnesota.
The quality of these tests right now vary a great deal, and that's a challenge in terms of understanding if you get a negative result, is it really negative?
A molecular diagnostic test can determine if you have actual virus inside of you by drawing a sample from your nasopharynx or from your saliva by spitting into a vial like I did and then testing it for genetic traces of the virus. How well the test can find those genetic markers is known as sensitivity. If a test has poor sensitivity, it will result in too many false negative results. That means too many people testing negative for the virus when they are actually infected.
We undertook a study where we looked at over 200 specimens and tested them by all five methods. And there are differences between these tests.
Dr. Gary Prokof is head of virology at the Cleveland Clinic. He and his team found three tests to have sensitivity over 95%. The one from the CDC, Cepheid, and Roche, meaning they caught nearly all but 5% of cases. But the highly touted Abbott ID Now test, which can give results in minutes, missed up to 15% of infected patients. Another study found that it potentially missed 25% of infections. And that's a concern, because despite their negative test results, those people are actually infected and can still spread the virus.
You would never want to use that test to screen somebody in the hospital to put them into a COVID negative unit, because in that case, you can't afford to make a mistake.
In a statement, Abbott said that the type of viral transport media, the chemical used to carry the virus sample, could be diluting samples. We immediately communicated with our customers that they should use the direct swab method. The findings of Prokof's study are still yet to be peer-reviewed.
Just because we need something put out emergently doesn't mean we should put out things that don't work appropriately.
When asked if accuracy was sacrificed at the expense of speed, an FDA spokesperson told CNN, FDA oversight doesn't end with an EUA, or emergency use authorization. We will continue to track these tests and take action if required.
Mr. Manafort, did you commit a crime?
Paul Manafort seemed destined to be heading to one of America's most feared lockups, Rikers Island Jail in New York, known for its brutal conditions and accusations of excessive force by guards. For a man used to million-dollar homes in the Hamptons in Florida, who wore python and ostrich skin jackets, and whose health is a concern with his lawyers, it would have been daunting. But tonight, Donald Trump's former campaign chairman is instead currently being housed at a federal prison in Manhattan, the Metropolitan Correctional Center. That's after Attorney General William Barr's deputy, Jeffrey Rosen, intervened. Rosen wrote to the Manhattan District Attorney seeking his input on where Manafort should be held.
It is extraordinarily unusual and perhaps even entirely unprecedented for somebody as high-ranking as the Deputy Attorney General to get personally involved in the designation of one particular inmate.
Another former prosecutor says the risk here is the optic of special treatment for Manafort.
If I were Manafort's attorneys, I would read this as a very hopeful message that the president and, by extension, the AG may still be looking out for us. They haven't forgotten about us.
2 weeks ago, a source told CNN prosecutors in New York were trying to move Manafort from the federal prison where he was being held in Pennsylvania to New York, possibly Rikers. Now, Manhattan DA Cy Vance says he never took a position on whether Manafort should be at Rikers. This federal prison in New York where Manafort's being held now is the same facility where convicted drug cartel chief Joaquin El Chapo Guzman is being held. Experts say while MCC is not Rikers, it's no picnic for the 70-year-old Manafort.
It's a small jail, it's overcrowded, and it is cramped. And I don't know that they have a wing for protective custody individuals like Paul Manafort, because we don't have a lot of prisoners like Paul Manafort.
Manafort is serving a 7.5-year sentence after being convicted on federal charges of bank fraud, tax fraud, and lobbying violations. He's now awaiting trial on several New York state charges, including mortgage fraud. President Trump can't pardon Manafort on those state charges, but could pardon him for the federal conviction.
I don't even discuss it. The only one discussing it is you.
On the question of whether political optics played a role in where Paul Manafort is being jailed, a senior Justice Department official tells CNN the department decided to err on the side of caution and keep Manafort at that federal jail in New York simply because New York prosecutors didn't object to that proposal from Manafort's lawyers. The official said the reason the Justice Department checked with the New York prosecutors on this was because Manafort's lawyers, who were concerned about his health, told the Bureau of Prisons they were worried about him being moved to Rikers. So Wolf will see how long he stays at that Manhattan correctional facility.
CNN is reporting that the Trump administration will not implement the CDC's 17-page draft recommendation for reopening America, according to a senior CDC official. The same official told CNN, quote, a team of people at the CDC spent innumerable hours in response to an ask from Debbie Birx, end quote. Why are those guidelines not being used? And even the guidelines that you put out for the coronavirus task force for states, according to testimony, most of the states that are reopening have not actually met the criteria that you set out.
So thank you. There's two questions there. One, we're in deep partnership with CDC, both for the White House guidelines that were put out on how to open up America again, but also the details behind the guidelines. And we're working with the CDC on a whole series of products, from how to improve community mitigation, what to do about contact tracing, how to improve surveillance, and certainly these more detailed guidelines about childcare and camps. And those are still being worked on. No one has stopped those guidelines. We're still in editing. I just got my edits back from the CDC late yesterday. I'm working on them as soon as I get off of this discussion. So we are in constant work with the CDC and really value their partnership. And as you know, they put up guidelines quite often. They just did a Meatpackers guidelines. And so I really want to appreciate how proactive they have been in working with the White House and really ensuring that the best science is put forward, both in our White House guidelines, but also in the guidelines that they post on the CDC website.
Is that what guides the edit, science? Because it seems like from some of the comments coming out about these guidelines that it's also, you know, political beliefs, religious beliefs. I mean, is it scientific? Is it scientists who are making the edits?
Well, I like to believe that I'm a scientist and I've been working with the CDC on the edits. It was more about simplification to really make sure that both the American people as well as public health officials understand the guidelines. And then really working on a whole area on surveillance for asymptomatic individuals. And that was a very new element that we felt very strongly had to be included because of the ever-increasing evidence of asymptomatic spread.